Yo, hello. So today I want to talk about a different occurrence of Tracy Widdom. So I mean, last lectures we looked on the statistics of the largest eigenvalues of random matrices, and we saw that this is governed by a very specific distribution, the Tracy Widdom distribution, and I gave you some idea how this looks like and how it can be described. I mean, the technical details are tough, so I didn't prove all. The main details I didn't prove. And again today, I will switch to a quite different subject where Tracy Widdom also shows up, quite surprisingly. And again, details are quite tough, so I just want to give you the idea why, what the setting is and why maybe from a very high level, why Tracy Widdom shows up there. Okay, and this is about the longest increasing subsequence of permutation, and if I look on random permutations, then I can ask about the statistics of this longest increasing subsequence. So it's about the statistics of the longest increasing subsequence of random permutations. And permutations a priori have nothing to do with random matrices, so it's quite unclear and surprising why in this context Tracy Widdom should also show up. Good, but before we go into this, let me first explain a little bit what the longest increasing subsequence is and a little bit about the history, because this is really something which was considered independent and before random matrices. Good, so let me first define increasing subsequence. So this is about permutations. So we are looking on a permutation sigma in Sn, in a permutation group on n letters. And then we say that this has an increasing subsequence of a length k. So this is said to have an increasing subsequence of a length k. So we are mostly interested in the length of such sequences. So if the following happens, if I find somehow a set of numbers k where the natural order between them is not changed, not destroyed by the permutation. So if there exist indices, and of course I mean for my permutation acts on 1 up to n, so I'm always taking 1 up to n, and now I'm finding between 1 and n, I'm finding numbers i1 less than i2 up to ik less than n, so which are arranged in increasing order such that pi does not destroy this order, such that after applying the permutation I still have the same order. Such that also sigma of i1 is less than sigma of i2 is less and so on sigma of ik. Okay, and if I find such guys, I mean I have found k indices, so this has length k. Of course there might be another index, I could have length k plus 1 and so on. Okay, and of course I'm interested in the ones which have the maximal length. And of course instead of increasing, I could also look on decreasing ones, where just of course here, I mean, I still have this order and then the permutation just exchanges the order, so that those guys here are decreasing. So let me also define this. So for a decreasing subsequence of length k, we just exchange the order here. The above holds with the second set of inequalities reversed. It's the second set of inequalities reversed. Huh? So I mean, I'm still fine that the I1 up to ik are ordered in this way, but after applying sigma, it's ordered in the other way. So I have here always strictly greater. Okay, and so what we are interested in is the length of the maximal, or the, yeah, the maximal length of increasing subsequences, and that's what I'm denoting by ln of sigma, let's say. Huh? So that's the quantity which I want to understand. What is the length of a longest increasing subsequence? And I mean, longest increasing subsequence is not unique. Huh? There might several be subsequences which have the same length, but I'm just interested in what is the maximal possible length which I can find. So for a given sigma in Sn, we denote this maximal length. We denote the length of, not of the, but of n, of, there might be more, of an increasing subsequence of maximal length. Maximal length among all increasing subsequences. So this I denote by ln of sigma. So it's a function of sigma. And just to remind us that we are working in the permutation group on n letters, I'm putting in n here. And of course, in the end, we will be interested in understanding this if n goes to infinity, the asymptotics of this. Good, but before we look on understanding this as a random variable by putting distribution on the permutations, let us just look on this concretely. Maybe first look on examples just to see what can happen. And of course, the maximal length of an increasing subsequence is of course n. No? And of course, this can happen, but this can only happen if I really have for one special permutation, namely for the identity. So if my sigma is the identity permutation, and I'm writing usually permutations in the way I have permutation is a function on a bijection from 1 to up to n to itself. So I'm just writing 1 up to n here, and then I'm saying to which this is mapped. So 1 goes to 1, 2 goes to 2, n goes to n. That's the identity permutation. And of course, this has an increasing subsequence. I mean, I just can take all of them. The ordering is not changed. So this has, of course, length n. So this guy has an increasing subsequence of length n. And actually, it only has one which has this, but that's okay. Increasing subsequence of length n. So this means ln of the identity is equal to n. And of course, if I'm looking on decreasing subsequences, then of course, I mean, I have a very, very big, very long increasing subsequence, but I only have very short decreasing subsequences because the order is destroyed for any pair of indices, which means a decreasing subsequence consists only of one letter. If I take two of them, which are ordered, then they are still ordered in the same way, so they are not becoming decreasing. So this means a decreasing subsequences only have length one. So all decreasing subsequences have length one. Okay, and then of course I have the situation where this is more or less exchanged if I'm taking the permutation, which really flips everything around. So which maps 1 to n, 2 to n minus 1, and so on. So if I look on, let's say I call it sigma 0, so this is the permutation 1, 2, up to n minus 1 and n, which just exchanges the small ones with the big ones. So 1 goes to n, 2 goes to n minus 1, n minus 1 goes to 2, and n goes to 1. So I'm just exchanging the order. And this means, of course, in this case, I don't have real increasing subsequences. Again, the length is only 1. Whenever I take 2 two different numbers which are ordered, then after applying the permutation, the order is changed. But now, of course, I have long decreasing subsequences. Namely, I can take the whole sequence. So I mean, this is ordered in a natural way, and here it's really replaced by greater. So this means I have here the increasing subsequence, for which I have a symbol, so ln of sigma 0 is here 1, but this is somehow compensated by the fact that I have decreasing subsequences of maximal length. But there is a decreasing subsequence of length n. Good, okay, and yeah, before we look more into this somehow relation between decreasing and increasing, maybe let me also make a few more general remarks, and maybe let me do an example which is not of this extremal situation. So let us look on typical permutation. Let me consider now sigma is now, let's say n is equal to 7, so it's a permutation on 7 elements. So I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. And so, yeah, let's say 1 goes to 4, 2 goes to 2, 3 goes to 3, 4 goes to 1, 5 goes to 6, 6 goes to 5, and 7 goes to 7. So that should be my permutation. And now if I want to find increasing subsequence, I have to look in this in this vector here, where I find a sequence of increasing numbers. So for example, I have here, I can take the 2, the 3, the 5, and the 7. So this is an increasing subsequence of length 4. I mean, I look at 2, 3, 6, 7, and then the corresponding images, 2, 3, 5, 7, they still have the same order. Okay, and I mean, this is somehow the longest I can find, so length 4. I mean, it's not the only one, because I can also take, for example, 2, 3, 6, and 7. This would also be an increasing subsequence of length 4. So it's not that there's a unique longest one, but I mean, we just look which what is the length of the possible maximal length. So in this case, the length is 4. I mean, okay, you should check that there is no longer one. Of course, we also have smaller ones. I mean, for example, you can take 1, 6, and 7. This is an increasing subsequence of length 3. And of course, also, if you have length 4, of course, you find all smaller ones. Good, okay, so I mean, in this case, I think there are only two which have length 4, namely exactly those. So is there one more? I don't know. No, you can replace 2 and 3. No, I think there is no other one. Anyhow, at least we have two. So 2, 3, 5, and 7. Or 2, 3, 6, and 7. Are longest increasing subsequences. So this means this ln, in this case n is 7, so L7 of our sigma is equal to 4. So the length is 4. Okay, how about decreasing? What are decreasing ones? For example, 4, 3, 1 is a decreasing one, or 4, 2, 1. Okay, so there are decreasing ones of length 3. So 4, 3, 1, or 4, 2, 1 are decreasing subsequences of length 3, and I think they are no longer decreasing ones. Or does anybody see longer ones? 4, I don't think so. Oh, gut. 4, 3. Gut. Okay. And so you see, I mean, how we can find, I mean, the increasing subsequences if we write our permutations in this way. Not in a cycle. Usually we are writing permutations in a cycle notation, but this is not so useful for looking on increasing subsequences. So if you really write it as a mapping, and then you just have to find here the increasing sequences of numbers. And you can also draw this in a graphical way. Maybe let me just put this here, and then of course you are finding a somehow increasing path in your picture. Yeah, so let me draw this permutation also in a graph-like way. I mean, really drawing the graph of this function. And then, of course, increasing subsequence also consists of essentially a path in this graph which just goes up. So in the graphical representation, where I'm drawing the graph of my permutation. So the permutation is a mapping on 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. In this case, on 7 numbers. And they are mapped to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Okay, so in this case, 1 is mapped to 4. So this is here. 2 is mapped to 2. Here, 3 goes to 3, 4 goes to 1, 5 to 6, 6 to 5, here, and 7 to 7. Okay, and then of course an increasing subsequence is a path where I'm going to some of these vertices, which is just going up. So for example, the 2, 3, 5, 7 would be this guy here. I'm just choosing a subsequence of the vertices here such that if I connect them, I'm going up. And the other one would be 2, 3, 6, 7. So 2, 3, 6, 7. Good. So the longest, an increasing subsequence corresponds to such a path, and I'm trying to find the longest ones. So an increasing subsequence. Corresponds to a path that always goes up. Good. Maybe I also want to say a word about the relevance of such increasing subsequences. And they are, for example, relevant in the context of algorithms, in particular in the context of sorting algorithms. Because they, I mean, sorting means that you want to bring a permutation into the normal order, and the subsequence also contains part of the order. A sorting algorithm, usually you can do algorithms where you are sorting around increasing subsequences. So let me just make this remark. I mean, that's one of the reasons that longest increasing subsequences are important and were considered and play a role. So longest increasing subsequences are relevant for sorting algorithms, for sorting algorithms. So maybe, yeah, I think you have a library of books. I mean, the books are, okay, let's say numbered, and they are just somewhere sitting on your shelf, and you want to bring them into their alphabetically or their natural numbered order. And what you can do, I mean, you take out a book and you can put it somewhere else. Okay, and of course, the simple sorting algorithm would just to take the book number one, put it at the beginning, book number two, next, and so on. Okay, but for this, of course, you would have to do n operations, because you have to take out every book and put it at some place. And the question is, can you do better? And actually, you can do better. And what you can do is, I mean, if you already have an increasing subsequence, then those books are already in their final order. And you, I mean, you should not destroy this, but you should just order the rest, around the order which you already have. And I mean, it turns out that this is actually the best what you can do. So n, so I mean, the length of the longest increasing subsequence, those number of operations you don't have to do. So it's just n minus this number which you have to do for your sorting algorithm. Okay, so maybe. Yeah, so maybe let me write this down. So we consider a library of books. Consider a library of n books. Okay, and they are labeled bijectively with numbers 1 up to n. And they are just arranged somehow. Okay, arranged on a single shelf in our library. Good. Okay, and now the configuration, of course, how they are there is now just a permutation of 1 up to n. So the configuration. Configuration of the books corresponds to permutation sigma in Sn. The question is, how many operations do we need to sort the books in a canonical order 1 up to n, or to change this permutation to the identity permutation? An operation, I mean, it's really just taking out a book and put it somewhere else. So how many operations do we need to sort the books in their canonical order? To sort the books canonical order 1 up to n. Okay, and as I just mentioned, what you need is, I mean, if without any information, you could do it in n steps, just taking out each book and put it where it should belong, starting with one. Okay, but if you have an increasing subsequence, you can keep this this part of the books essentially in their order, and so you only need n minus the longest increasing subsequence many operations. So it turns out that the minimum number is n minus ln of sigma. And so essentially you can sort around the increasing subsequence which you already have. Maybe let us do this for an example. But I mean, it should be clear. And I mean, you cannot do better, because for the other books, the order is destroyed, and so you have to reinstall it again for them. Yeah. Okay, so. Yeah, so. So essentially, one can sort around an increasing subsequence. And of course, you should then take an increasing subsequence which has the longest length. Subsequence. So for example, assume we have, let's say, a permutation 4, 1, 9, 3, 2, 7, 6, 8, 5. So this is a permutation of 9 books. So we have 9 books, and they are put in this order in the shelf. And this has an increasing subsequence. Let's say I have 1, 2, 6, 8. So that's an increasing subsequence, and I think there is no longer one. So we have an increasing subsequence of length 4. And those books, 1, 2, 6, 8, are already in a good order. So we should not destroy this order, but only rearrange the other ones. And so, of course, now what what we can do now, 1 and 2 are in the right order, so now we take 3, and where should it go? Of course, it should just go after 2. So that's the place where it should go. So I put 4, 1, 9, and then I put this after this, and then I have 2, 3, 7, 6, 8, 5. And now I have, of course, 1, 2, 3, and 8 are in the right order. So I have 1, 2, 3, and now 4 is the next guy, which I should take care of. And so I take 4, and where do I put it? Of course, here, where it belongs. So I have then 1, 9, 2, 3, and putting the 4 there, and then 7, 6, 8, 5, which means I have now 1, 2, 3, 4, I was missing the 6, 8 in the right order. So now 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 is now at the wrong place. So I'm taking out 5 and putting it here. So then I have 9, 1, 9, 2, 3, 4, putting 5 there, and I have 7, 6, 8. And now 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and 8 are good. 7 is not good, so I put then 7 here, and at the end I'm putting 9 here. And then I have, and so you see, I have, how many operations do I need? I need 5, because, 4 books were already in a good order. Those I don't have to do anything, but for the other 5 books I have to use one operation. So this shows that I can do it with at most n minus the number of increasing subsequences. And then one just has to think that you cannot do better, because I think this is also somehow clear. Okay, so we need here 9 minus 4 equal to 5 operations to sort. N minus ln sigma. Good. Now, of course, this is if you have an increasing subsequence, the longest increasing subsequence, you can do something with it. And of course, the question is, what can you say about the length of the longest increasing subsequence? So what is the typical behavior of this? Or in particular, can it be that you don't find any really long ones? And we have seen it can happen that you have only longest increasing subsequence of length 1. But we have seen that in this case you have very long decreasing subsequences. And this is a general feature. You can avoid long increasing subsequences, but on the expense of having long decreasing subsequences. So you can avoid one type of order, but then you get the other type of order. And this is a general phenomena which somehow fits into Ramsey theory, and maybe here in this context there is a very specific theorem on this which makes this very precise, saying that essentially, if you want to avoid decreasing subsequences, you get increasing ones, and you can somehow control the relation between them. So maybe because I'm not really going to prove anything serious about Tracy-Williams stuff, maybe I want to prove this nice theorem here, because it fits into this frame, and it's a nice theorem anyhow, and it's also a nice proof. So maybe you should see at least this once in your mathematical life. And it fits into this general Ramsey theorem, which tells you that complete disorder is impossible. Huh? So I mean, if you try to avoid some order, at least you usually see some other order. Huh? And Ramsey theorem makes this precise by saying what type of orders of which size you find. But it's very hard to get a precise estimate how big your setting have to be and how big the suborders should be which you find. And in this setting of the longest and increasing and decreasing subsequence, there's a very precise theorem on this. And that's what I want to show. Before we then go into the connection with Tracy Widom. Good, okay, so maybe let me first make this as a remark before I state and prove the precise theorem. Okay, so so one has situations with small increasing subsequences, or let's say with only small, no? Of course you always find small ones, but there are situations where you cannot find long ones. So if you have small subsequences, for example, the permutation which just exchanges the order, so this one, but then in this case you have long decreasing subsequences. But then one has long decreasing subsequences. And this fact is true in general, that if you can avoid having long decreasing subsequences, or you can avoid having long increasing subsequences, but you cannot avoid both at the same time. So if you want to exclude having long increasing guys, you will have long decreasing ones. Of course, we have to see what long means. So of course, not as long as here. So this is true in general. So namely, one cannot avoid both long decreasing and increasing subsequences, both long decreasing and increasing subsequences at the same time. So for the same permutation. Okay, and this is somehow, this fits into this setting of Ramsey theorem, which can be characterized by maybe this general slogan that complete disorder is impossible. Okay, you cannot create total disorder. So if you avoid one structure, usually you can only do this on the expense of having some other structure. So complete disorder is impossible. And this is a slogan which usually is attributed to Motzkin. Good. Okay, but so maybe let us make this precise. So there's a very precise theorem in this setting, which goes back to Erdős and Csikaris, which really tells us that if we have in a permutation group of a given size, we find either increasing or decreasing subsequences of somehow a given length. Okay, so namely, if the permutation group has size n squared plus 1, then we must find a monotone subsequence of lengths more than n. Which means we find a subsequence which is of the order square root of the size of the permutation group. And that's also the typical somehow behavior, that the length of the longest increasing subsequences are of the order square root of the size of the permutation group. Of course, there are very specific ones where we have length n. We have specific ones where we have length 1, but typically the longest increasing, the length of the longest increasing subsequence will be of the order square root of n. Good. And this theorem tells us that usually we will find at least either monotone or increasing or decreasing in such a situation. So this is by Erdős and Szigorús. So from 1935, quite old theorem. But it's in a sense maybe it's one of the nicest theorems in the Ramsey theorem setting because it's so precise. So every permutation sigma in a permutation group, and now I say the permutation group should have size n squared plus 1. Okay, so such a permutation has a monotone subsequence, so either an increasing or a decreasing one of length more than n. Okay, so it's at least n plus 1. So it has a monotone subsequence of length more than n. Okay, so this is true for each n. Good. Okay, and the proof is just a clever application of the pigeonhole principle, Schubfach-Prinzip. So namely, so how do we see this? So I'm writing my permutation again, that I'm writing down the images of 1 up to n. So I'm writing this as a1, a2, up to a, and I have n squared plus 1 numbers. So those are just the permuted numbers, 1 up to n squared plus 1, according to sigma. So it's just like here. So a1, a2, a3, and so on. Okay, and now I'm looking on information about longest, decreasing, and increasing subsequences, but not only overall, guys, but I keep more information, namely I'm keeping the information of the increasing subsequence which are ending at some point. So I'm not only looking at longest increasing subsequences for the whole thing, but even subsequences which end somewhere. So I only consider subsequences which stop somewhere. I don't care about whether I can extend them or what happens after them. And so I do this for increasing and decreasing one. So this means for each of those guys here, I assign a label, namely two numbers, xk and yk, where, so k is just a position, which means I'm looking at ak, and I record the information about the longest increasing and here decreasing subsequence, but not for the whole sequence, but for one which stops at ak. So I say xk should be the length of the longest increasing subsequence, but not of the whole numbers here, but one which is ending at ak. So I'm just looking on the first k parts of my numbers here. And I'm looking for longest increasing subsequences there, and yk has the same information about the length of the longest decreasing subsequence. Decreasing subsequence, and also ending at this point. Good. Okay. And now let us assume that my theorem is wrong, which means I have no monotone subsequence of length n plus 1 or longer. And this means, of course, in particular, also those increasing and decreasing subsequences, where I'm only looking up to some point, cannot have a length n plus 1 or more. So this means all this xk and this yk must be numbers between 1 and n. They cannot be bigger than n. Good. Okay, but this means that this pair here, xk and yk, only, I mean, the x's can only take on the numbers 1 up to n. This can only take on the numbers 1 up to n. So I only have n squared possibilities for them. Yeah, but how many of those pairs do I have? I have n squared plus 1, which means there must be at least one repetition. There must be two different k for which I have the same pair. And this will be a contradiction. So that's a pigeonhole principle. I have n squared pigeonholes into which I want to put n squared plus 1 things. So I mean, at least one pigeonhole must contain two things. Okay, and this will be a contradiction, as we will see. Because we can then find longer increasing or decreasing subsequences. So let me first write this down, what I just said. So we assume now that there's no monotone. There is no monotone subsequence of length n plus 1. N plus 1 or longer, because that's what our theorem claims, there is one. So by contradiction, we want to see what happens if we assume there is none. But then this means all the monotone subsequences which we consider there can also not be longer. They can be at most have length n. So this means that all the xk and the yk which we have there must be between 1 and n for all k. Okay, but the k is running from 1 up to n squared plus 1. Of course, I mean the k's are just all those positions here. Yeah, so this means there are only n squared possible labels, possible pairs, xk, yk, which I can have. So there are only n squared possible, let's say, pairs. Okay, but I have n squared plus 1 labels, which means at least two of them must have the same pair. So by the pigeonhole principle, which in German is the Schubfach-Prinzip, we know that there must be at least two labels, I different from j, such that at this label, the pair xi, yi must be the same as the pair xj, yj. Yeah, okay, now we can just analyze this, what happens here. And so, I mean, of course, we have here I and j, and of course it's symmetric, so we can assume I is less than j. So take I is less than j, because that's we are free what we call I and what we call j. And then in this situation, I mean, so we have two different positions here, I and j, and now there are two possibilities for the a's which we have there. I mean, either aj is less than ai is less than aj, or the other way around. And so let us look on those two situations. So the first situation is ai is less than aj. Okay, so yeah. So what does this mean? So this means if I'm now looking on increasing subsequences, I will have an increasing subsequence which ends here. So I mean the xi is the length of the longest increasing subsequence which ends here. Okay, and the xj is the length of the longest increasing subsequence which ends here. Yeah? But of course, if I have a longest increasing subsequence which ends here, I just can append to this aj, yeah? Because I still have here the increasing order. Yeah? So this means the length of the longest increasing subsequence which ends here is at least one bigger than the length ending here, yeah? Because I can append every increasing subsequence ending here, I can append the aj and make it by one longer. So I can append the aj to the longest increasing subsequence ending at aj. But then I get for the longest increasing subsequence which ends here, I get at least one more. So this means that the xj, which is the length of the longest increasing subsequence ending here, is strictly greater than the length for here, ai. And of course, this is a contradiction to this, because here we have seen that x. This pair should be the same, so in particular xi should be equal to xj. So this means this situation cannot be the case. This would give a contradiction. Okay, but still we could have the other situation. So namely, it could be that ai is greater than aj. But then we do the same with a decreasing subsequence. Because now, if I have a decreasing subsequence, which stops here, then I can just append the aj, and I get a decreasing subsequence, which is one longer. And this means, of course, that the device cannot be the same. So in this case, I append aj to the longest decreasing subsequence ending at ai. And then I get a subsequence which ends at aj, but which is one longer. So this means that the yj, which is the length of the longest decreasing subsequence ending here, is strictly greater than the yi, which is the length of the longest increasing subsequence ending here. But again, this is a contradiction, because the pair is the same, so both the x's as the y's should be the same. Okay, and so the two possibilities which we have lead that either the x's are not the same or the y's are not the same. So in any case, it leads to a contradiction. So this is a contradiction, and this is then the end of the proof, because it shows that, yeah, if we assume that we don't have a monotone subsequence like this, we get a contradiction. Good. Okay, so I hope you can appreciate the beauty and the simplicity of this proof. And this is a really proof where you have to know how to do it. So it's really, I mean, you're asking about longest increasing, decreasing subsequences, but in the proof you put more information, namely longest decreasing, increasing subsequences which stop at the various points. You keep take this more information, but this is then enough. Good. Okay. So this maybe is enough about general decreasing, increasing subsequences. And now we want to look on the probabilistic question. So how does the length of the longest, let's say, increasing subsequence behave? Yeah? No, I mean, so maybe let me say this again. So what I have done here, so yeah, because this comes later, so maybe let me make it a bit more precise. So this argument here, so let's say I have a1, a2, let's say n squared plus 1, so let's go to a5, just to be for a5. Okay, and now I have seen that I find two I and j. So let's say the I and the j would be the two. So this would be my I, and this here would be my j. So j would be 4, and I would be 2. Okay, and then what is... Okay, now assume ai is less than aj. So assume that a2 is less than this guy. Okay, and then what is the xi? The xi is telling me about subsequences where I'm just looking on those two guys. I'm just looking up to this point. So if I have a longest subsequence here, for example, let's say a1, a2 is a decreasing subsequence because the a2 is less. So if this is increasing, so let's say, I mean, this is an increasing subsequence up to this point, which would mean the x2 is equal to 2. But now I know that the a4 is bigger than this, so if I go up to this point, I can add to this the a4. Then up to this point, I have an increasing subsequence of length 3. But my assumption was that x2 is x4. So if I have here length 2, I should here only have length 2. But because this guy is bigger, I can just add it. Because this is now up to this point, this is an increasing subsequence, which is one length longer than this one. And if it is the other way around, if this guy here is bigger than this guy, I can append this to a decreasing subsequence. Yeah, I don't care about A3 here because I don't know anything about A3. I mean, A3 doesn't play a role for this. Because, I mean, I just have to find, so, I mean, a subsequence up to this point, which is strictly longer than a subsequence up to this point. For any subsequence up to this point, I can just append this and I get one which is one longer. And, I mean, this I can just ignore A3. Good, yeah. Okay, yeah. Yeah, so this is essentially really a very beautiful proof, so it's worth really to understand it precisely what is going on. And it is really setting up what, I mean, this X and Y. It contains a lot of information, but it's exactly the information which you need. It's not just looking on subsequences for the whole sequence of the A's, but also looking for sequences which stop at some point, because then you can compare such guys. Good, okay, but now let's go to the random permutation. And of course, I mean, if I fix n, then I have a finite number and factorial permutations, and I just make them random by giving them the same probability. So this means each of them has probability 1 over n factorial, and I can ask now a probabilistic questions. So namely, what is the probability that the length of my longest increasing subsequence is so and so? So the length of the longest increasing subsequence will now become a random variable, and we can ask about expectation and distribution. In particular, asymptotically, if n goes to infinity. Okay, and this has some history. So maybe let me first talk about the history. In the beginning, it had nothing to do with Tracy-Widom, but the final answer really is more or less Tracy-Widom. Here's the history of this. So what we are looking now at is the statistics. So we are now interested in the statistics of this function ln of sigma, if, of course, n goes to infinity. So we expect maybe a nice behavior if n goes to infinity. And of course, statistics, so this means we need a probability, but in this finite setting, of course, we put the same probability on each permutation. So this means we put the uniform distribution on our permutations. So this means each permutation has a probability 1 over n factorial for all permutations in our Sn, and we consider the function Ln from Sn to, let's say, R, of course it goes to integers or natural numbers, we consider this as a random variable. Okay, and the question is, what is the asymptotic distribution of this guy? What is asymptotic distribution of this random variable ln? Good. Okay, and so this problem was maybe considered on this level or brought up as this problem by Ulam. So it's also known as Ulam's problem. I mean, actually, there are various problems which are called Ulam's problem, so one should be a little bit careful, but I mean, there's one of them. So Ulam's, which is exactly this here. So this also runs under the name of Ulam's problem, and this was raised somehow in the 1960s as a kind of problem of understanding this. Good. Okay, and then, I mean, Ulam and other people did a lot of numerical investigations and had some ideas, but of course in the beginning it was even hard just to get what is the expectation of this quantity. I mean, very far away from really a detailed analysis of the distribution, but even the question what is the expected value of the longest length, I mean, I told you, it should be of the order square root of n, but even to prove this, and to say exactly whether there's a coefficient, this took a while. So actually, the first contribution was by Hammersley. So this was in 1972. So namely, he showed essentially that it is of the order square root of n, the expectation, and that there is a coefficient. So he showed that the limit, let me call it lambda, so this is the limit of the expectation of ln, so the expected value of the longest length compared to the square root. So that this limit exists, and actually we have that this random variable divided by this converges to this in probability. So I mean, even those simplest questions are not so clear, and actually he was not able to show what lambda is. Of course, you would expect a precise value, and there is one, but in the beginning it's even hard to see what this is. So this limit exists, and so lambda n scaled by square root of n converges to lambda in probability. So this means the probability that the difference between this and lambda is bigger than epsilon for any epsilon goes to zero. Yeah, and then it took another couple of years, because it was finally proved what lambda is, and it's a very nice, and it's just two. But I mean, in the beginning there were numerical experiments which showed maybe it's between 1.5 and 2.5, so it was also not so clear. And this was shown essentially by two group of people independently. So one is Vershik and Karov, and the other is Logan and Chep. So they showed in 1977 that actually this lambda is equal to 2. Okay, so this means that the expectation of ln behaves like 2 square root of n plus something which goes to 0 with the square root. So the typical the average of the length of the longest increasing subsequence is like 2 times square root of n. Yeah, okay, and then, of course, there were more numerical experiments by Odlitsko and Rains and other people looking on the variance and all those stuff around this. And then, actually in 1998, there was a final theorem, which is quite surprising and really give a definite answer to this. Namely, it tells us that actually this guy here behaves, if you do the right scaling, in exactly the same way as the maximal eigenvalue of the GUE random matrices. So this was then shown by Baik, Dave, and Johansson in 1998 that actually this expectation here, first of all, more precisely, it's like 2 square root of n. But what are the fluctuations around this? And the fluctuations of the order n to the 1 over 6. And then you have an O of this. So you can also say something about the fluctuations. And again, you see the fluctuations have a strange n to the 1 over 6. Like in a random matrix case, we had to do the scaling in maybe an unusual power of n. And here it's the same. The fluctuations are somehow going with strange power. But if you then divide by this power, then actually you will get again the Tracy-Widom distribution. So more precisely, what they showed is the following. Precisely is, if I take the limit n going to infinity of the probability, so I'm taking ln, I'm subtracting the mean, this is 2 square root of n, and I'm dividing by the fluctuations, which are of order n to the 1 6. And this probability that this is less than t, this has a limit. And the limit is exactly the Tracy-Widom distribution. So you remember, Tracy-Widom was given, here I'm taking the largest eigenvalue of my random matrices, I subtract the expected value, which was 2 square root of n, and then I divide by some other power. So the size was somehow different, but I had to divide by some other power. And this limit for the random matrix, this was what we called, which was also shown to exist. It is called Tracy-Widom distribution, and there are this description by the Airy kernel and by the Penleve equations. But so it turns out that here in this setting, which a priori has nothing to do with random matrices, we get the same Tracy-Widom distribution, the one of the GUE, so what we called F2 of T. So this is the Tracy-Widom distribution. Good, so this is a very, maybe, surprising, and of course, I mean, it also depends on numerical, to get the idea that this is the same. I mean, of course, it depended on the fact that we got an understanding of Tracy-Widom, of this largest eigenvalue, but also numerical estimate showed that maybe there might be a relation. But still, it's quite surprising, and I want to give you a very high-level, maybe, sketch of the proof to give you an idea why it could be related with Tracy-Widom. So again, I'm not really proving things now, it's just making saying a few general words which maybe rings a bell that maybe it could be related to Tracy-Widom. And maybe I will say a few more words on parts of this proof. So it goes via a few steps, and somehow I want to give you the idea how could this permutation question related with questions on the largest eigenvalue. And maybe you remember the largest eigenvalue, we saw this was coming out because we had a description of probabilities related with the largest eigenvalue. So we had in the limit the Airy kernel. So somehow here it would be nice to see that there's also a description which has something to do with determinantal formulas, because then maybe you also have a kernel there, and maybe this kernel goes to the same airy kernel. Yeah, okay, but and so to see this connection, yeah, maybe let me give you a sketch, but this is really a very rough high-level sketch of a possible proof of this Baek-David-Johansen theorem. Okay, so first of all, you translate the problem from a permutation group to Young diagrams. Okay, and there's a very famous mapping which does this. So there's an ISK correspondence which relates permutations to Young diagrams. And maybe I will say a few words on this. But so first of all, this ISK correspondence, this is an algorithm which relates somehow permutations to Young diagrams. Okay, and of course, under this algorithm, the quantity of interest, the longest increasing subsequence, also can be seen very nicely on the Young diagrams. So the Ln, our quantity in which we're interested, so this goes under this mapping to the length of the first row of the diagram. So Young diagram is given by rows, and so the length of the first row, this corresponds to the longest increasing subsequence. So this Ln goes under this mapping to the length of first row of the diagram. And I will probably say a bit more on this, because this ISK is an important thing, which independent of this proof, it would be good to see this. But okay, so this is so you can move the problem from permutations to Young diagrams, which of course are not so far away from permutations because they index the irreducible representations of the Young diagram of your permutation groups, but they have somehow they are closer to where we want, and in particular you can associate to the Young diagrams non-intersecting path. So next correspondence is that these Young diagrams correspond to non-intersecting path. Okay, and I mean non-intersecting path was also something which showed up for the eigenvalues of our random matrices, and we had this general theorem of Gessel and Viennot, which told us that non-intersecting path actually have a determinantal form. Okay, so questions, probabilities about non-intersecting path are given in terms of in terms of kernels, of determinants of some kernels. Okay, so this means so we are getting closer to things which we already used for the largest eigenvalue. So this was this Gessel Viennot. So the relevant quantities in which we are interested about those paths, so the relevant quantities in terms of non-intersecting paths have a determinantal form. And then we are somehow in the same setting as we had it for the eigenvalues, of the random matrices. And then, of course, we looked, I mean, the idea was that you look on the kernel, which is involved in this determinantal form, and you show that this converges to the airy kernel. And here, of course, you then have to do the same. You have to identify the kernel which you have here. Of course, the kernel is now not given by the Hermit kernels as for the random matrices, but it is given somehow else, but still in the right scaling and in the limit, it also converges to the Airy kernel. And of course, this is the main work. I mean, this is again tough work. But at least, I mean, you're moving somehow to a similar setting as for the random matrix. So maybe this gives you some idea why at least there's a chance of expecting also the Tracy Willem to show up here. So we show, not we, but other people showed that the involved kernel, and of course you have to scale this again, somehow at the edge, and with the right scaling, which here, I mean, this is a different scaling as for the random matrices, but it's the scaling which captures the variance of this problem here. So, I mean, the idea is, if Tracy Willem shows up, I mean, you should look on the expected value, take the difference to this, and then scale it on the right scale, and then maybe there's a chance that what you get there goes to Tracy Willem. The features from the problem are the expected value and the size of the fluctuations, which might be different for different problems. But if you then do the right scaling, then it's like a central limit theorem. Then you get something which is kind of universal. So, okay, so this suitably rescaled converges to the Airy kernel. That's the one which we got for Tracy Willem, and then you also know that you have this description by Penleve equations and all those things. Good. Okay, so I mean I cannot tell you anything about part four. I can tell you a little bit about the other things. And so maybe let me in particular tell you what this ISK algorithm is, this correspondence. I'm not sure, maybe you have seen it before, but it's a nice thing, so it cannot hurt to see it more often. And if you haven't seen it before, then it's really something which you should know at least that this exists, because it really relates permutations with Young diagrams. And this is an important relation which is used in many situations. But let me first tell you what are Young diagrams and Young tableaus. Which are of course related to the representation theory of the permutation group. And I think they were essentially introduced for understanding the representation theory, the irreducible representations. Yeah, so this ISK, so ISK stands for three different people. So so this is the ISK correspondence. So ISK stands, so R is Robinson, S is Schenstedt, and K is Knuth. And I mean, they did, different versions and general versions of this at different times. So Robinson is quite old, 1938. Then Schenstedt is 1961. And Knuth is 1973. And very often this is also just called RS, Robinson-Schenstedt, because maybe the basic thing was there and Knuth did more general versions of it. Okay, so what this does, it gives a bijection, and I mean it's really a precise bijection between the permutation group and pairs of tableaus of the same shape. So I take here lambda, so this is a Young diagram, and I will explain and define this later. So a Young diagram of size n. So I'm taking the union of all Young diagrams, and for each Young diagram I take the tableaus, so this is a filling of a Young diagram, and there I'm taking pairs of those guys. So I take a pair of two tableaus, but corresponding to the same lambda. I'm going over all Young diagrams, and there's a bijection between such pairs and elements in the permutation group. And before I tell you precisely what this bijection is, or let me define what Young diagrams and tableaus are. Good. Okay, so I mean a Young diagram is a way of drawing partitions. So, but partitions of numbers, not partitions of sets, which always showed up in our random matrix calculations, but we have here partitions of numbers, so of number n, let's say. N is a natural number. So partition of n, so this is just the number n, not the set 1 up to n, as we usually considered. So this is a sequence, I mean, this is just the partitioning of n into a sum of integers. So it's a sequence of integers. Let's say lambda is my partition, so it's a collection of those integers, lambda 1 up to lambda r, let's say, such that the lambdas are ordered. So lambda 1 greater or equal lambda 2, and so on, up to lambda r. And they should be all greater or equal 1. And they should sum up to n. So it's just a decomposition of n as a sum of lambdas. So the lambda, the sum of the lambda i's, I running from 1 up to r, should be equal to n. And usually, we denote the fact that lambda is a partition of n by this symbol. So this guy here. Lambda is a partition of n. Okay, and currently, one denotes such a partition by a Young diagram by just taking n boxes and putting them in rows and columns, such that lambda 1 is the number of boxes in the first row, lambda 2 the boxes in the second row, and so on. It's just a graphical way of writing a partition. So graphically, a partition lambda of n. So this is represented by a Young diagram with n boxes. So I have here a partition of n, so I have n boxes, and I just drawing the number of boxes in the first row. So this is lambda 1 many. Okay, and then I'm starting here with lambda 2. I'm putting lambda 2, so I have also here sum. And I mean lambda 2 might be the same, might be equal to lambda 1, but it cannot become bigger. So this means the number of rows might stay the same or is getting smaller. So I have here lambda 1, lambda 2, up to lambda r. Yeah, okay, so that's just a Young diagram. So it's just a picture like this. And now what is important is a Young tableau. And a Young tableau is a filling of such a Young diagram with the numbers 1 up to n. I have n boxes, and I can fill them with 1 up to n. But the tableau must satisfy the condition that the numbers in the rows and in the columns, they are ordered in a natural order. So a Young tableau for a given Young diagram, a Young tableau, let's say of shape lambda. So it's a tableau which corresponds to a Young diagram lambda. So it is a diagram, but together with a filling of the numbers 1 up to n, satisfying those constraints. So this is the Young diagram lambda filled with the numbers 1 up to n. So I'm using each number exactly once. I have n boxes, so I want to fill in those numbers in the boxes. But under the constraint that the numbers must be increasing in each column, and in each row, and they must be decreasing if I'm going from top to bottom in each column. So filled with numbers 1 up to n, such that we have the following. In any row, in any row, the numbers are increasing from left to right, and in any column, the numbers are also increasing, but from top to bottom, Okay, and so for a given Young diagram, there are usually several Young tableaus, so and I denote the set of Young tableaus by tab of lambda. So we denote the set of Young tableaus of shape lambda by tab lambda. Good, and so let me make a few examples and maybe also give some remarks. Okay, so maybe first example. Of course, if n is equal to 1, there's only one Young diagram. So I mean, 1 can only be written as 1. There's no other way of decomposing it. So the only lambda is just this guy here, which corresponds to one box, and of course there's also only one filling. I can only put the one into this box. So the tableaus corresponding to this lambda, this is just the box where I put in the one. So this is trivial. So for n equal to 2, there are two Young diagrams. So namely, I can write 2 as just 2, or I can write it as 1 plus 1. I have a lambda which is given by two boxes, which are arranged in this way. This corresponds to the fact that 2 is equal to 2. Or I have a 1 and a 1. I have a lambda 1 is 1 and lambda 2 is 1. So this corresponds that I write 2 as 1 plus 1. So I have two Young diagrams of size 2. And for each of them, I only have one filling, one possible filling. So the tableaus for each of them only consists of one element. Because, it has to be increasing in a row and in a column. I must write them into the increasing order. There is no freedom, which I have in those cases. So, let's say the tableau of, let's say, this guy here. What is this? I have to fill in the numbers 1 and 2. And, of course, because it must be increasing, I must do it like this. And, of course, the tableau for the other guy is in the same way. I must fill it in like this. And maybe more interesting is then the case 3, because then I'm getting a bit more flexibility. So let me also do this. So for n equal to 3, there are three different Young diagrams. So namely, I can write 3 just as the 3 without any decomposition. So 3 is equal to 3. I can write it as 2 plus 1. So I have a 2 plus a 1. Or I can write it as 1 plus 1 plus 1. Then, of course, I have the boxes like this. So it's 1, 1, 1. 2, 1, and just 3. Okay, and now, of course, In this case, so for this Young diagram, again, there's only one possibility for getting a Young tableau, namely putting 1, 2, 3. And the same is here, 1, 2, 3. I don't have a freedom, but here I have, I can make some choices. So there are two possibilities. So maybe also let me write this down. So the tableau for this Young diagram, so this consists actually of two tableaus. So namely, I can fill in the numbers like this. I mean, the one must go here, that's clear. Okay, but the two, I can put it here, or I can put it here. And then, of course, I have the three here. So I have here the two possibilities for doing this. Yeah. And, yeah, maybe an important interpretation of these Young tableaus actually is that a Young tableau corresponds to a walk in your Young diagrams, or it tells you how to build up a Young diagram from nothing, such that you always have valid Young diagrams in between. So, which is also a good way of connecting Young diagrams of different sizes. So note, I mean, a tableau contains more information, of course, than just a tableau of shape lambda, than just the diagram itself, but it tells you essentially how you build your Young diagram starting from nothing, where you put one box after the other there and just running through valid Young diagrams. So note that a tableau of shape lambda corresponds actually to a walk from, let's say, the empty set to lambda by adding one box in each step, by adding one box in each step, and only visiting Young diagrams. So maybe let me just give an example to make this clear. Yeah, because this is a quite valid, interesting point of view if you want to relate the representation theories of different SNs. For example, so let's say I have a Young diagram of 8 boxes, and I have filled in 1, 2, 4, 8, 3, 7, 5, 6. So this is a Young tableau. Numbers are increasing in this way, and they are increasing in this way. Okay, but how I should see this? This corresponds that actually I have a walk. I start with nothing. Then I put in one box, the one, and now I want to grow this. And now I could do it here or here, but this tableau tells me I should grow here. Okay, and then I have the possibility for a valid Young diagram. I can put a box here or a box here. But this tells me I should put it here. And then, again, I can, next step I could put one here, or one here, but this tells me I should put it here. 4, and then 5, I'm going like this, and then 6, and then I put here the 7, and I'm always have valid Young diagrams. I mean, I can put a box here, one here, one here, one here, but of course I cannot put a box here, for example. This would not be a valid Young diagram, because the number of the lengths here must be not decreasing. Must be not increasing. Okay, so the next is 7, and then the last one will be here. And so actually each Young tableau corresponds exactly to a possibility of getting the final shape. So it is really a bijection between these shapes. Yeah, the Young tableaus and works, how producing the Young diagrams. Good, okay, so I have a few more things to say about this, but so maybe time is over for today, so maybe we stop and I will say a bit more on this next time. Okay, thank you.